So we're just going to dive right into the Word here this evening. This is a third section of the extended upper room series in John's Gospel, chapter 13 through 17. Tonight, we've covered 13, 14, half of 16, and we are going to do our very best to put a cap on that tonight. So I'll just say a quick prayer here before we get into the Word. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessings in this Thanksgiving and holiday season. Father, for the blessings that you continue to just pour out graciously on your people, Lord. We're thankful for the facilities that you provide here, the buses that can go out, the faithful workers that selflessly volunteer their time, energy, efforts, Lord, for your kingdom, for your purpose, for your word. We just lift this whole evening, this whole campus up to you tonight. Father, the teaching downstairs, the teaching across the parking lot for the youth. Father, we just pray that it's a pleasing aroma to you, Lord. And we especially thank you for a glimpse into the word this evening. Holy ground, essentially. Father, I just pray that the cares of the day, the worries of the day, would just melt away for a little bit as we settle into your word, as you give us a window to peek into at this very special time, this last gathering of your disciples, your high priestly prayer for them, for yourself, for us, Father, as the hour has come. Just pray that your word goes forth. Pray an anointing over it. In Jesus' name, amen. So, certainly turn your Bibles to John chapter 16. Put your finger there, but we will be we'll actually start out in Luke chapter 9. So if you have, you got two fingers, use those, use both of them. So just a little recap of where we're at in the scripture. Matthew, Mark, and Luke's gospel, the account of the Last Supper, certainly powerful, certainly strong, but John's gospel, his account covers four chapters, this Last Supper before that hour where Jesus was betrayed, Jesus pouring into his disciples, the longest account. They're wrapping up a week of controversy. A week ago, or maybe 4 or 5 days ago, before this evening, Jerusalem certainly abuzz. Jesus shows up in Bethany and has dinner with some Pharisees, Mary, Martha, Lazarus, whom he raised from the dead. He's anointed with perfume and tears. Certainly starting to create additional controversy, the controversy that was already there. Enters into the holy city, into Jerusalem, triumphantly, it says. Palm Sunday. The Hosanna, Hosanna. In the holy city, he clears the temple, goes into the temple, tipping over tables in a display of righteous anger at the defilement of the temple. Really creating the town was a buzz already, but Jesus has come and really put it on edge. You know, the confrontation, the controversy, the Pharisees looking for ways to capture him, looking for ways to corner him after he clears the temple. Parables and confrontation in the streets, trying to trap Jesus. Little cat and mouse, if you will. You know, the opposition is solidified as Jesus goes into the Last Supper with his disciples. And he gathers them. And in Luke's gospel, again, it says, you know, he's eagerly desired to have this meal with them, eagerly desired to share this time with them. If you're open to chapter 16, maybe just flip back here. We'll see where we're at. In 13, Jesus washes his disciples' feet in a wonderful display of love and servant leadership. He puts an exclamation point on action over words. You know, in 13:17, he says, "Now that you know these things, you'll be blessed if you do them." Servant leadership. He predicts his betrayal. He claims deity. You know, "I say these things to you now so that when they happen, you will know, you'll believe that I am who I said I am." He predicts his betrayal from Judas. He predicts his betrayal from Peter. "Before the rooster crows three times, you will deny me." They're reclining and relaxing at the table. Sets the evening on edge. "I'm troubled in my spirit." Jesus is troubled. The disciples, start to talk amongst each other. A new command he gives to these guys in chapter 13. "Love one another as I have loved you." He sees their discomfort, and he starts comforting his disciples. Affirmations. "You know, I'm going to a place to prepare for you, and I will come back and take you with me. I am the way, the truth, and the life," he says. Jesus promises the Holy Spirit, the advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything that I have said to you. They're really getting into this Trinitarian type of language. There may be no clearer spot in Scripture than these four chapters where we get a real glimpse at the Trinity, the Trinitarian nature of our God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. "I will send the Holy Spirit from you, from the Father, in my name." And we see how this, we see this interaction, and the disciples are certainly piqued. They're not quite sure exactly. There's a veil still that's there. We talked last time about the vine and the branches. "He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit," expecting his disciples, expecting his followers to bear fruit for his kingdom. "I no longer call you servants, but I call you my friends," letting them in on the master plan. No longer servants, but my friends. Starts talking about the work, you know, of the Holy Spirit. "He will testify about me. It's better for you if I leave. That way, the advocate will not come unless I leave." The advocate, the Holy Spirit, must be a super powerful and important thing if it's better if Jesus leaves so we can receive the Holy Spirit. Certainly kind of maybe foreign language to them. "He will guide you into all truth and righteousness," the Holy Spirit. So Jesus, as we get into chapter 16, verse 16, starts talking about his death again, not for the first time. So if you still have your fingers there in Luke chapter 9, let me get there myself. In Luke chapter 9, verse 21, Jesus predicts his death. He says, so right after Peter declares that Jesus is the Messiah, "Who do people say that I am?" Jesus confronts his disciples with. "Who do people say that I am?" Well, you know, some say Elijah, some say John the Baptist, but he turns and he asks them the most important question any man will ever answer in their entire lifetime. "Who do you say that I am? Who do you say that Jesus the Christ is?" Peter answered, "God's Messiah. You are the Christ." In verse 21, he says this, "Jesus strictly warned them not to tell this to anyone. The hour had not yet come," it would say in another account. And he said, "The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests and the teachers of the law, and he must be killed on the third day and be raised to life." Now in Mark's account, and if you're taking notes, that's in chapter 8. In Mark's account, at this time, Peter actually grabs Jesus and pulls him aside and attempts to rebuke Jesus. He says, "Hold on a second. What are you talking about? What are you saying? Do you know who you are? You're not going anywhere. You're going to rise to power. You're going to remove us from the Roman yoke, and you're going to set up your kingdom. That's what's going to happen, Jesus. Don't you know who you are?" Pulls him aside and Jesus says, "Get behind me, Satan. You're thinking like a man and not like the things of God." So Jesus predicts his death. Peter actually tries to rebuke him. later in that chapter, in verse 43, says Jesus predicts his death a second time. They were all amazed at the greatness of God. While everyone was marveling at all that Jesus did, he said to his disciples, so another, again, at a high point, Jesus, who are you? I am the Christ. Don't tell anybody. While everyone was marveling at all that Jesus did, again, he said to his disciples, listen carefully to what I'm about to tell you. The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. But they did not understand what this meant. It was hidden from them, so they did not grasp it, and they were afraid to ask him about it. It's funny, in verse 46, they just kind of breeze right over this thing, and they say an argument started amongst the disciples as to which one of them would be the greatest. So Jesus is here talking about his death a little bit, and it says for some mysterious reason, they didn't understand it because they were ignorant or they couldn't comprehend what he was saying. The scripture tells us that it was hidden from them a bit. So you see this veiled type of language, so they didn't grasp it. And they were afraid to ask him about it. They didn't like what he said. They didn't understand it. And they didn't even want to ask him about it. Instead, they breeze right over the thing and they start arguing about who's the sweetest one amongst them. So it's like, let's get out of that conversation and check me out. In Luke 18, verses 31, says this, Jesus predicts his death a third time. Jesus took the 12 aside and told them, and he kind of, a little more clarity here, listen, we are going up to Jerusalem, and everything that is written by the prophets about the Son of Man will be fulfilled. He will be delivered over to the Gentiles. They will mock him, insult him, and spit on him. They will flog him and kill him. On the third day, he will rise again. Again, in verse 34, the disciples did not understand any of this. Its meaning was hidden from them, and they did not know what he was talking about. So very clearly, three times, at least, Jesus is predicting his death before this time, before this moment, before this time, this Last Supper with them. Certainly, subtly, and on many more occasions. Over the disciples' head, it was hidden from them. They didn't understand it. They were afraid to ask him about it. What's he talking about? As we get into the scripture here tonight, John 16, 16, Jesus kind of turns to this point again. So after all this time, by now, it's late into the night. He's been pouring into his disciples here for quite a while. They've been drinking from a fire hose, if you will. He's been really laying it on them. The scripture says, I have much more to say to you, more than you can even now bear. And he's pouring into them. Half of it's maybe sticking, not even that. But, you know, later you will understand. You know, he goes on until they're overwhelmed. You know, there's some clarity, but this veil is still there. But the veil's kind of getting pulled back a little bit. Jesus is revealing more and more to them, and they're starting to understand it a little bit better. They're confused, distraught, hanging on by a thread, you know, but turning a corner. And in John 16, 16, he says this. Again, Jesus went on to say, in a little while, you'll see me no more. And then after a little while, you will see me. No longer necessarily afraid or non-engaging this fact that Jesus is talking to him about his death, that this, they start talking amongst themselves. That this, some of the disciples said to one another, what does he mean by saying, in a little while you will see me no more? And then after a little while you'll see me. And because I am going to the Father. They kept asking, what does he mean by a little while? We don't understand what he's saying. What is this guy talking about? He keeps talking like this. I don't understand it. What's he saying? In spite of their fear that they had previously, it's different right now. This moment is, they're feeling something at this moment. Again, they don't know what's going to happen hours from now. Jesus certainly fully aware of everything that's about to happen. The disciples do not, but they're certainly feeling something. And he goes on to say, Jesus saw that they wanted to ask him about this, so he said to them, are you asking one another what I meant when I said, in a little while you will see me no more, and then after a little while you'll see me, very truly I tell you, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will turn to joy. And he just nails this analogy in verse 21, of course he does. A woman giving birth to a child has pain because her time has come. When her baby is born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that a child is born into the world. So with you, now is your time of grief, but I will see you again, and you will rejoice, and no one will take away your joy. So he expands on this previous. He just doesn't let it sit and gloss over before. He dives a little bit deeper into this prediction about what's about to happen, and he's about to die and go through a tremendously horrible, disfiguring, bloody death. And what does he do? He comforts his disciples. I mean, you guys have been around people on their deathbed, and people are all, you know, gathered around them, holding their hands, patting them on the head, maybe a cold rat, something like that, and you're comforting them. Jesus comforting his disciples, it just really blows me away as we read into the scripture. It's like, hey, don't worry about me. I got this. You guys, here's what's going to happen. Your grief will be turned to joy. And you know the feeling? I mean, I've watched my wife deliver 4 children. The first one was really something. I had never seen anything like that before in my life. Tears of pain and agony, red-faced, beautiful. Rondell, beautiful. And absolutely. And then instantly, tears of pain to tears of joy like that. I can't even understand that they lay her on the mother, on her mother's chest. Tears of joy, pain gone. You would think they would never go through that again. We had 3 more. So he nails this analogy. Think about your own. Some of us have wonderfully beautiful testimonies. We've grown up knowing the Lord. Some of us have come to know the Lord from horrific situations. My own testimony. I came to know the Lord through a agonizing trial and tribulation in my life. Came to a spot where I left off. I didn't have any answers. I had through when you boil it all down, through pride and arrogance. I took all my money, all my savings, and poured it into a business in the worst economic depression since the Great Depression. Lord broke me to my knees. But through that situation, he revealed his truth to me. He revealed himself, proclaimed him as Lord and Savior. Would I change that for anything? Absolutely not. I'd go through it again 10 times. Best thing that's ever happened to me. Grief, turning to joy. And he explains this to disciples. You're going to mourn and you're going to grieve, but I'll see you again. And no one will take away your joy because it'll be real. When I came to know the Lord, I went from a place of knowing about the Lord to knowing the Lord, where it was real, where it was in my bones, where the Holy Spirit indwelt me. Nobody can argue me out of that thing. Nobody can take away that joy. Paul says, I know what it's like to be rich. I know what it's like to be poor, to have little, to have much, but I always have a contentment. I know the secret of contentment through the Lord Jesus, that no one will take away your joy because it's real. And these guys, years later, every single one of them about died bloody for this truth and died bloody for this joy. Nobody could take it away from them. They would not deny it. Real. In verse 23, in that day, you will no longer ask me anything. Very truly, I tell you, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask and you will receive, and your joy will be complete. In that day, what day? In that day, he's talked about the Holy Spirit. Earlier in this chapter, a couple weeks ago, he's talking about the work of the Holy Spirit. In that day, when you receive the Holy Spirit, you will no longer ask me anything in my name, or you will no longer ask me anything. Very truly, I tell you, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. In 16, 15, the last verse, all that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you. in that day, you will no longer ask me anything. Listen, up until this point, they asked Jesus a lot. They had to explain the parables to them. Why can't we cast out demons? Why, you know, they would always ask Jesus, and no longer would that happen because they would be empowered by the Holy Spirit that will guide them into truth, that will give them the answers. He will take what is him and make it known to them. Jesus, why? No longer. You know, In that day, I am bridging the gap between God and man. I am giving you direct access to the Father. You can ask him directly in my name. That hadn't happened before. To go to God, the priest went to the Holy of Holies and, you know, once a year, and he had to petition for his people. Jesus bridged the great chasm between God and man. So you have direct access to the Father. My Father, he will give you everything, whatever you ask in my name. Listen, when we go to the Father in the name of Jesus Christ, the door gets opened. You know, this business I was telling you about, I had to make cold calls, and I hate making cold calls. That's like the worst thing ever. Pick up the phone, blocked, secretary, and I had to call, like, leaders of organizations. I was calling directors and VPs and presidents of mid to small-sized companies. And blocked every time. After so much time, my dad had some highfalutin friends, some high connections, and after he saw, I was serious about this business, he opened up his Rolodex a little bit and gave me the names of about five or six guys. And when I called and said, my dad, Steve Mitchell, said that I could call you, they picked up the phone. I was no longer calling in Steve Mitchell Jr.'s name. His name gained me access to what I wanted access to. It's like that with Jesus. By his name, we have access to the Father, and that's what he's doing in that day. You'll no longer ask me. You'll be empowered by the Holy Spirit. I'm giving you the answers that you need, and you have direct access to the Father. When you pray according to his will, ask him anything. And what are we asking him? He's not asking, hey, listen, there was a $400 million lottery ticket. I don't know if that's God's will that you win the lottery and we're praying for that. Hey, I asked you in my name. But were we prompted by the Holy Spirit to ask for that? Were we asking in his will or were we asking in our will? Bridging the gap, direct access through the rest of chapter 16 here. Jesus says, though I have been speaking figuratively, a time is coming when I will no longer use this kind of language, but I will tell you plainly about my Father. In that day, you will ask in my name. I am not saying that I will ask the Father on your behalf. No, the Father himself loves you because you have loved me, and I believe that I came from God. I came from the Father and entered the world. Now I am leaving the world and going back to the Father. A light goes off. Then Jesus' disciples said, now you are speaking clearly and without figures of speech. Now we can see that you know all things and that you don't even need to have anyone ask you questions. This makes us believe that you came from God. Verse 31, do you now believe? Jesus replied, and with a word study and in context, this is really like an affirmation, not necessarily a question. Jesus replied, a time is coming and in fact has come when you will be scattered, each to your own home. You will leave me all alone, yet I am not alone. For my Father is with me. I have told you these things so that in me you will have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. Though I have been speaking figuratively, a time is coming when I will no longer use this kind of language, but I will tell you plainly about my Father. We'll speak clearly. Jesus was full of like these veiled, pointed statements up until this time. After here, I don't think we have a recorded parable in the rest of the scripture. The Holy Spirit, Jesus speaking plainly and clearly to the disciples by the power of his Spirit. These veiled, pointed statements at times, you know, I'm living water, drink my blood and eat my flesh. I am the bread of life. These things the disciples, you know, maybe caught just bits and pieces of, you know, before Abraham was born, I am. This language that he spoke at those times, you know, they maybe just caught a bit of it, struggled to pick it up, but no longer. You are now speaking clearly, like this aha moment. The veil gets pulled back even further as to really what's going on here. So there's a clarity. Maybe this meaning is no longer hidden from them, like it is, like it was earlier in those other accounts of Jesus predicting his death. Jesus' disciples said, now you are speaking clearly and without figures of speech. The veil is pulled back. You know, a fuller revelation of Christ. What's about to happen, the most epic moment in human history where eternity back intersects with eternity moving forward. You know, all of mankind looking forward to the cross, all of mankind after that looking back to the cross. That moment is at hand. They're seeing that. You know, the no more parables. You know, they write the word. They write the word, empowered. Christ speaking very plainly and clearly to them. You know, moving forward, glimpses into the heavenly. Listen, these guys, you know, afterward it says Paul was caught up to the third heaven, you know, seeing more clearly this fuller revelation, the revelation to John, the last book in the Bible. This is very clear to them, no longer veiled. You know, now you believe. So Jesus is comforting them. You know, he's ensuring God's love. Verse 27. No, the Father himself loves you because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. This affirmation, this confirming their faith from God. You know, I believe, talking about the incarnation. You believed in the incarnation, the deity of Jesus Christ, you know. The Jews said he had a demon, yet these guys believe he came from God, setting them apart, comforting them. You know, giving them hope, a joy. You know, hope produces joy. Without hope, do we have any joy? And you'll see that through these, we've talked about the last few, joy is a big part of what he's trying to impart upon his disciples. It is their joy made complete through who Christ is in them. We can be happy, but I don't believe that a man can have true joy unless they get that resonation of the Holy Spirit, that who they are created to be. And that's only possible through Christ. You know, giving them hope, a hope producing a joy, you know. He's about to endure the cross, and Hebrews 12:2 says, For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame and sitting down at the right hand of the Father. For the joy set before him. Well, what joy is that? I have overcome the world. Overcoming the world is part of that joy. Reclaiming his position at the right hand of God. Taking off the human flesh, putting back on the glorified body. Back into his position of glory where he was from the beginning. That joy set before him. Redemption of mankind, bridging that chasm that exists created by sin. I will be their God and they will be my people. I got this. You guys, don't worry. I got it. The Father will be with me. A time is coming and is in fact coming when you will be scattered, each to your own home. You'll leave me all alone. But hey, don't worry about me. I got this. The Father will be with me. I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. You'll have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. So from that moment, he's wrapping it up with his disciples. And he turns and he prays to the Father in John 17. Now he said much up until this point. Again, very late into the night. And we see Jesus praying often through the scripture. But very rarely do we get a glimpse at what he's actually praying, the words that he's saying. We get little bits and pieces of it here and there, but this is Jesus' longest recorded prayer. And essentially, saying it out loud, certainly intentionally, so his disciples could hear it, so we could read it. Essentially holy ground, this prayer. The communion between the Son and the Father, certainly Jesus praying in the will of the Father, knowing the Father's will. This prayer is like on. When you pray in the will of the Father, it's just say, ask in my name according to my will, the book of James says, and it will be done for you. You think Jesus is going to pray in anything except the will of the Father? So we get a glimpse, we get to peek into this holy ground of Jesus praying to the Father, saying these words. He's prayed much, but we never get to see it like this. And he lets his disciples peek in, and we're blessed to be able to read the recorded word for their sake, for our sake. You know, the Hebrews calls Jesus our great high priest, praying for us. You know, he's ending his earthly ministry, in all accounts, and transferring into his intercessory ministry, where he's there right now, interceding on our behalf. And we see it here, broken up into three clear sections. So we see at the beginning, verses 1 through 5, Jesus prays to be glorified. He's praying for himself. He's praying for the glory, his glory, the Father's glory. And he turns and he intercedes on the behalf of the disciples, and he starts praying for his disciples in verses 6 through 19. And then lastly, he closes by praying for all believers, you and me, as we sit here today, praying for us, knowing exactly who we are, knowing exactly who's written in the book of life at that moment, praying for them at this time, praying for us, praying for them, our great high priest, interceding for us. And he says, after this, Jesus said this. He looked toward heaven and prayed, Father. Not praying like the Jews. They couldn't even say God's name. This is very intimate. If a Jew was listening to this prayer, if a Pharisee was listening to this prayer, it'd be blasphemy. Father, like daddy, very intimate. The hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. Father, the hour has come. Again, what hour? Let's turn back a couple chapters to John chapter 12. In John chapter 12, verse 23, Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds." Verse 27. "Now my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. It was for this very reason I came to this hour. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. The crowd that was there and heard it said it thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. And Jesus said, this voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for the judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up," certainly speaking of the kind of death he's going to die, "when I am lifted up from this earth on the cross, I will draw all people unto myself." He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. "That hour, the reason that I came, I will draw all people unto myself." The Holy Spirit, what did we say last time? The Holy Spirit guides us all into truth. And when we're seeking the truth, we end up at the cross. Jesus, the power of the Holy Spirit, drawing all men unto himself. Glorify your Son. See, this is a prayer only Jesus could pray. Right? In Matthew chapter 6, when he's talking about the Lord's Prayer, he's like, this is how you should pray. Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Forgive us our sins. Jesus never had to pray for forgiveness of his sins. He was sinless. That's how you should pray. Jesus can only pray to if I was to go home and pray, glorify me, that's not going to work out too well for me. Jesus is the only one that can pray this prayer. Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that your Son may glorify you. The Lord Jesus, God, has a deep, deep passion for his glory. I mean, I went to the concordance and looked at the word glory. Anything with the root of the word glory, glorified, glorious, glory, it is like stacked. God is he has a very deep passion for his own glory. Psalm 19:1, the heavens declare it. It's on display right now. We go out, the heavens declare your glory. And the scripture is littered with God and his glory. And I have it up here on the screen, but Isaiah chapter 48, I'm just going to turn there quick and read it. Isaiah 48, verse 9. For my own name's sake, I will delay my wrath. For the sake of my praise, I hold it back from you, so as not to destroy you completely. See, I have refined you, though not as silver. I have tested you in the furnace of affliction for my own sake. For my own sake I do this. How can I let myself be defamed? I will not yield my glory to another. That's what Satan tried. Satan wanted some of that glory cast out of heaven. Father, glorify your Son. The hour has come. Glorify. The hour has come. Let's turn to Matthew chapter 27. Matthew chapter 7, or 27, I'm sorry. Verses 50, starting in verse 50, we'll go through 54. The hour has come. Glorify your Son. This is the hour that has come. Matthew 27, verse 50. And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook, the rocks split, and the tombs broke open. The bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life, busting out of the grave. They came out of the tombs after Jesus' resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those with him were guarding Jesus at the cross, watching him die, the skies darkened, the earth shook, the rocks split, the veil had been torn. Surely, they said, they were terrified and exclaimed, surely he was the Son of God. Glorified. The hour has come, that hour where the veil was ripped open, where the bridge was crossed. Surely he was the Son of God. That hour. We see in these verses that Jesus is glorified. In verse 2 and 3 here, you grant him authority over all that he may give eternal life to all those you have given him. We see God's initiation in our salvation. God gives it to the Son. He gives, like procuring a bride for his Son. That's you and me. Eternal life, glorifying the Son. So he's glorified through eternal life of those that given to him, drawing men, knowing. This is eternal life. What is eternal life anyway? That they know you. Not necessarily a quantity, which there certainly is that. Listen, there's eternal existence for everybody born of man. It's a matter of where you spend that existence. What is eternal life? Knowing God. It's a quality, not necessarily a quantity. A quantity, sure. But there'll be eternal existence in the lake of fire as well. There'll be eternal existence in hell. But he says, this is eternal life, that they know you, defining it. He gains glory by completing a life of perfection. Man, verse 4, I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. Boy, that'd be nice to say when we're done. Finishing the work, it's hard enough for us to figure out the work he's given us to do, let alone finish it. Spend a lifetime trying to figure out what we're supposed to do. I was saved for a purpose, and I know it. My wife will tell you, years ago, 20 years ago, unsaved, here by the grace of God only, knowing about God, but not knowing God, escaping death several times. I'm sure we all have those stories, but I told her, and she'll remind me of this day, you told me, Steve, that God saved you for a purpose. Kind of took her by, you know, took her by surprise. That myself took me by surprise. And I chase that down, and we try to figure out what that is. Some days better than others. Finishing the work you gave me to do. Could we glorify God by finishing the work that we've that He's given us to do? Absolutely. Some days better than others. He's glorified by providing eternal life. He's glorified by completing a life of perfection. He's glorified for the restored position that He has. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. From the beginning, the Alpha, the Omega, He was there in the beginning. Had to. 2 Corinthians says, though He was rich, for our sake He became poor, so that we, through His poverty might become rich. And I have this in Philippians here up on the screen. Philippians chapter 2, verse 6. Who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to His own advantage. Rather, He made Himself nothing, leaving the throne room of heaven by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, taking on our flesh, and being found in appearance as a man, He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross, leaving His heavenly abode willingly for the joy set before Him, becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Verse 9, therefore God exalted Him to the highest place, glory, gave Him the name that is above every name, that the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. God has a deep passion for His own glory, and we should as well. Shifting gears, he moves from Himself to His disciples, praying for His disciples. He first, you know, affirms their position. You know, who's He praying for? His disciples. Verse 8, for I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. What does that mean? That they have a righteous position before God. They have put their faith in Jesus Christ, affirming their position. Who's He praying for? He's praying for His disciples, for those given from God. And I'll go from 9 here to the end of the chapter, so bear with me. I pray for them. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. And glory has come to me through them. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe by the name you gave me. None has been lost except the one doomed to destruction so that the scripture would be fulfilled. Certainly Judas Iscariot. Verse 13, I am coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth, by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them I sanctify myself, that they too may truly be sanctified. So he certainly says a lot there about his disciples, but he's praying for what? Verse 11, he's praying for protection. Protect them while they're still in the world. Listen, he doesn't ask them to go and remove them into a Christian bubble. He sends them into the firing line, right into the front lines. Protect them. How? By the power of your name. The only name with true power. You know, David to Goliath, you know, he says, you come against me with sword and spear, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the power of the name. Proverbs 18:10 says, the name of the Lord is a fortified tower. The righteous run to it and are safe. Power in the name. You see later these disciples in Acts chapter 3, you see Peter and I think John walking by. They see a lame beggar and they say, look at us. Silver and gold, I don't have anything, but in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk. That kind of power, claiming the promises that God has given them. Man, when we invoke that name, there's power in that name. God has given us promises that are ours for the taking. Not name it and claim it. I'm not saying that. But he has given us the fruit of the Spirit. Are we living it? There's power in the name. Man, we try to fix stuff by our name sometimes. But how is he going to protect them? I pray for their protection. How? By the name that you gave me. Why? So that they may be one as we are one. He prays for their unity. And we'll speak more about that when we get into all believers, you know. Joy. So they may have the full measure of my joy within them. Jesus continues to pray for the joy of his people. The only joy that's possible, full joy, real joy, true joy by his power. He prays for their unity, and he prays for their sanctification so that they would be set apart. Right? Sanctification is being set apart, that they would be sanctified, that they would be in unity, set apart, but unified. Set apart from the world, but unified. I don't pray that you take them out of the world. You know what? Send them into the world. And some of us need to go into the world, and we retreat, and we go into our Christian bubbles. Yeah, everything's great. Ah, praise the Lord. Isn't everything wonderful? These guys are going into the firing line, and he doesn't ask that they're removed. He asks for their protection from the evil one, from Satan's grip to the front lines. And he prays for all believers. So he prays for his disciples out loud. Remember, he's praying these. And disciples standing around him, listening to this, us right now, being able to witness this holy prayer, this holy ground. Verse 20, my prayer is not for them alone, but I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message. Man, that displays some confidence from Jesus to the disciples. Not that may believe, but that will believe in me through their message. So they're hearing these words. Hey, you know, people are going to believe in the name of Jesus based on our message. How cool is that? Right? So praying not only for them, but for those who will believe. Who's that? That's you and me. Right? These 11 guys changed the world a couple thousand years ago. Created a movement by the power of the Holy Spirit, caught on like wildfire, praying for us. We stand on the shoulders of these guys, the early church fathers, praying for us right now. Now, I'm not only praying for these disciples, but I'm praying for those who will believe. He's praying for the church, praying for his bride, his precious bride, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. This unity, he's praying for unity. And man, we've kind of failed there, haven't we? Not just any kind of unity, special unity. The unity that the Son experiences with the Father. That's not just us getting along. That's a special kind of unity. Pray for them as so they will be one as we are one. Listen, we have one mediator, one intercessor, Jesus Christ, our intercessor. The Bible says when we sin, we have an advocate. He's praying for us at the right hand, praying for us. One mediator. And why does he need to do that? Because we have an adversary in the devil, accusing the brethren, accusing us day and night before God, active on earth, active in heaven. You know, Jesus says to Peter, Satan has asked to sift you guys like wheat. But Jesus is interceding on our behalf with these prayers for protection, for unity. The church will be built on you guys. You know, this would-be band of misfits, right? We talked about these guys being bad fishermen. They can never catch fish. Bad fishermen, tax collectors, you know, this band of misfits building the church. Jesus looks at Peter and says, on this rock I will build my church. A very special, you know, kind of unity, this back and forth love. And man, God has shown me some things through this that I'm not necessarily talking about denominations, and man, there's a lot of denominations. There is a righteous separation that can happen. Listen, truth should never, ever, ever be the victim of unity. And the devil will take that word like he twists it. The devil will twist that word just like he does. And he says, are you going to go against the grain of Jesus? Come on over here. Let's water this down a little bit so we can all just get together and hug and just all be together. No, that's not what he's talking about. A sanctified by the truth. Your word is truth. Listen, now we divide on some things we shouldn't be dividing on. We major in the minors. There's a lot more that unifies us than what separates us. And there are some things that we should be dividing on. And I think God is with that. He doesn't ask for unity where truth is a victim of that unity. He doesn't ask for that. He asks for a unity, a holy, righteous, unified church. We will never cross the bridge of denominations, culture, worship, style, age. We will never cross that bridge. But listen, the Bible says there are many parts, but one body. God is using people in the Presbyterian denomination, the Baptist denomination, the Catholic denomination. God is using, there are saved believers in all those churches. I ask you, what divides us? Sound doctrine is worth dividing over. Truth should never be the victim of unity. A holy unity, righteously set apart for him. Many parts, but one body. That's a trap. I hope you know sound doctrine so you know when the dividing line is at hand. You know what I say? Paul says to one of the church, I don't know if it's the Ephesian church or church in Galatia, I can't believe how quickly you're departing from the gospel. Somebody's preaching another Jesus, which is no gospel at all. He's not asking for unity for the sake of unity. He's asking for unity, a unified, holy, righteous bride. I am praying for them that they are one. Listen, we have one mediator that can pray to the Father on our behalf. That doesn't mean you and I, as a unified church, can't pray for each other. And when we do, when that's prompted by the Holy Spirit, that's the unity he's talking about. When I'm prompted by the Holy Spirit to pray for a brother or sister in Christ, maybe even unbeknownst to them, but I'm prompted by the Holy Spirit to lift that person up, I can't intercede for anybody. Your grandmother can't intercede for you, your husband, your wife, Mother Mary, they cannot intercede for you. You have one mediator, and that doesn't mean we cannot pray for each other. Listen, when the Holy Spirit is whispering in our ear, whispering in our heart, and we're praying for our brother and sister, we're taking those petitions before the Lord, and Jesus is saying, my spirit prompted them, our spirit prompted them to pray for that. This is the unity he's talking about. As we are one, you know, it completes a circle. The spirit goes out, prompts us to pray. The praise get lifted up to the Father. Jesus is in his right ear interceding for us. This is the unity that Jesus is envisioning. I and them and you and me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Why? So the world will know that you sent me and have loved me from them and have loved them even as you have loved me. Listen, when from the outside looking in, when we get into this nasty division, and there has been nasty division in the church, we're defeating the purpose. We need unity. Why? So the world will know that you sent me. Listen, from the outside looking in, when people are looking at us and they see a unified body loving each other, the Father, Son, displaying this love that they have, they see something. They say, man, that Jesus must be really something. So the world may know that you sent me. But when they see from the outside looking in, and they see a train wreck and a mess and infighting and people suing each other and this, that, is that pointing to God at all? No. This unity is for a purpose. So the world will know you sent me. So it says something wonderful about the Son. I want those. So he's praying for a oneness, right? In Psalm 133 says how good and pleasant it is when we dwell in unity. A oneness that transcends all that other stuff. A oneness that rises above denominational differences. A oneness that transcends time, space, this country, that country. So he's praying for those things, but this last, in verse 24, this last thing that he's praying for us, maybe just the most awesome, the most staggering reality. What is he praying for? I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, praise the Lord. To be with me where I am for all eternity so we can see his glory. Now listen, bits and pieces of his glory have been displayed to mankind up until now. Peter, James, John, invited to this special, I think it's Matthew 17, with the transfiguration where God, you know, Jesus kind of, you know, slips a little bit of his glory out. And the Lord speaks and these guys are laid down prostrate. Moses comes down from Mount Sinai radiating the glory of God because he just got a little bit of a glimpse of it. He had to veil his face because they couldn't look at it. So Jesus prays that, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory. When we're raised up, when we're lifted up in our glorified body, the scripture says our bodies will be like his body, glorified. We'll be able to see the glory of God, and that's what he's praying for, and that's knowing God. This is the prayer, and this is the amazing reality, the marriage supper of the Lamb, the bride of Christ, when he comes back, we're glorified and lifted up. That's what he's praying for, that they will be with me, and they will see my glory. They will be here where I am, the glory you've given me because you've loved me before the creation of the world. You know, Christ's veiled glory, the veil comes off. You know, praying that we'll be able to actually lay our eyes on this glory in our own glorified bodies. I have made you known to them, and will continue to make you known in order that they love, and that the love you have for me may be in them, and that I myself may be in them. Continually drawing mankind. When I am lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself. This prayer is fantastic. We are stepping into holy ground when we see what the Son is praying to the Father about. He prays for preservation for his people, joy, praying for our joy, one of the fruits of the Spirit, liberation, so preservation, joy, liberation from what? Satan's grip. Sanctification, to be set apart, unification, glorification, and an association with him. These are what he's praying for us. Man, sometimes I get like one or two of those things, you know, when we get three or four, we start to get that going, and it's like, it's on, you know. I like to be prayed for, and I don't ask for it much. I don't, just to my own detriment. I do things on my own a little bit too much. I don't ask for prayer. I'm not just that people do, and that's great. And I pray for people when they ask me to pray for them. I just don't. Often. But sometimes I do, and I love it. And when people say that I'm praying for you, I know you got this going, I pray for you. Man, that's really special, isn't it? But what's even more special is that Jesus Christ interceding for us, praying for us. Man, I love to be prayed for by people. It blesses me when I know that that's happening, but to be prayed for by the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, man, we must be very, very special to him that he would do such a thing. So he rounds up this prayer. He's done. These guys are wiped out. These guys are exhausted. 18, verse 1, when he had finished praying, Jesus left with the disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. He says, let's go. And he goes into the Garden of Gethsemane for that fateful hour. Father, we thank you so much for your word, your truth, Lord, for a glimpse into this holy, holy ground, this communion between the Lord Jesus and the Father. Praying for us, certainly unworthy, undeserving of your prayer, Lord, but your grace and mercy abound, that you would pray for us, that you would pray for our preservation, that you would pray for our glorification, our unification. Father, help us by the power of your Holy Spirit to finish the work that you've given us, to be who you've called us to be. Father, we thank you for your truth. We pray that we could be sanctified by your truth. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a good night.